Hello and welcome to Beyond Blue Lights. I'm Natasha Kaplinski. In this programme, we look at the life-saving technologies, new preventative partnerships, and the changing role of fire and rescue services in our society. Coming up, lessons learned from the Somerset floods. Fire and rescue services boost mobilisation capability. Safer, less damaging, and more effective. The latest in high-powered firefighting. And superthermal vision reveals the dangers inside the new capabilities of thermal imaging. The tragic fire that claimed lives at the Bosley Wood Mill in Cheshire saw our firefighters once again undertake a tireless rescue effort in extremely difficult conditions. National resilience and rescue are an important part of the traditional role of fire services in this country, but that role is becoming much broader in our communities. Well, let's discuss this further now and speak to Peter Dartford, President of the Chief Fire Officers Association. Great to see you again.
Thank you.
You've given something like 34 years of service, haven't you? You must have seen a huge amount of change over the years, and you are making some changes to the brand, but do communities actually want that? Is there the desire for change?
Well, I think fundamentally, fire and rescue services are there to help people. And that is something that has remained consistent, certainly throughout my 30-odd years of service. But of course, the way we provide that help, the way we support communities has changed. Because when I joined all those years ago, the way we supported and protected communities was through emergency response. So when someone was in trouble, when they were in peril, we came and did what needed to be done to support them and to help them. But of course, nowadays, we've recognised we can do things before those bad things happen. We can take a far more proactive, preventative approach to reduce the chances of those bad things happening in the first place.
That's all good and well, but what about the day-to-day nuts and bolts of the operational rescue service? Is that going to be unchanged?
Absolutely, and in fact, we've seen in recent times quite a significant change in the type of incidents that we attend. We're attending much larger incidents, widespread flooding, you know, the tragic fire that you mentioned up in Cheshire. We're all incidents that we have to respond to. We have the capability to respond to, and through the national resilience arrangements and through our mutual aid supportive approaches, we have the capability and capacity to continue to deal with that. And of course, that's the thing that gives us that reputation with the community and that accessibility that allows us to carry out that proactive upstream preventative work.
The areas that you're planning to move into now, they're not necessarily areas that we would associate with you, are they? Tell us more about them.
Well, we've recognised that that things that increase vulnerability to fire are pretty much the same things that increase vulnerability to a whole range of other bad outcomes, so poor health, poor education, poor employability. And so we now work with partners such as local authorities, the NHS, to try and address those lifestyle choices, those things that people do that increase their vulnerability. And of course, we're now making a contribution to a much broader range of outcomes than we've ever done before. We're actually maximising the use and the value of the brand that we've got, our ability to engage with people to get some key messages across so that we improve their health, safety and well-being in a far more holistic way than we've ever done before.
Firefighters, there's something special about them, isn't there? They've always been our kind of community heroes. Are you worried that moving into these new areas will change that status within our society?
I'm not worried because I think it'll actually enhance and improve that status. The more people recognise the contribution that we're making that goes way beyond their traditional expectations of just firefighting or cutting them out of a crash wreck of a car, I think that will encourage them to value their fire and rescue service even more than they do today.
Well, we look forward to following your story. Thank you very much indeed for coming in and talking to me today.
It's a pleasure.
During the widespread flooding in the south of England in early 2014, we saw the biggest deployment of fire and rescue service assets since the Second World War. Specialist teams assisted their colleagues in the south, particularly in Devon and Somerset, where some of the worst flooding occurred. The valiant and tireless efforts of the crews made headlines, But important lessons were also learned about our national resilience, as Paul Brennan reports.
This news footage from 2014 shows the scale of those infamous winter floods in Somerset, Surrey and Berkshire. Tens of thousands of acres were submerged and thousands of homes and businesses ruined.
Good afternoon, how can I help you?
Central to this was the Standby Operations Centre at the National Fire Service College in Moreton-in-the-Marsh, Gloucestershire. Here we see it in simulation mode. It's manned by officers from CFOA's National Resilience Team who, at times of major incidents, report to the National Centre in London.
We've got the facility to analyse and to look at all the assets, to map the assets and to bring in the various dimensions of those assets in order that we can give the advice to the National Strategic Advisory Team and to the Chief Fire Rescue Advisor.
The clean-up operation ran for several weeks, drawing on expertise, support and sheer endurance from all those involved, whether at this centre, in London or on the ground.
Incredibly challenging. It was long days. Lots going on, lots of information to coordinate, lots of support from here out to my colleagues on the ground, and then compiling the reports to make sure that the Chief Fire Rescue Advisor had that information he could then pass on to government ministers.
Every officer we had for all the weekend 24-hour periods in the various strategic holding areas, in Silver Command, at the emergency room, the operations centre now, and at the National Coordination Centre. So we had resources to the very limit deployed, and here was operating throughout with the change in circumstances, with the priorities from the Thames Valley, from the southwest deployment, and all the cover moves that we had to put into operation as well.
Logistically, it was a large movement of assets into the Somerset area at very short notice. However, one thing we did find as a result of the mobilisation was just how resilient and reactive the Fire and Rescue Service is, and being able to move large numbers of assets quickly and effectively.
Among those assets and critical to the operation were these high volume pumps, or HVPs. There are 51 of them spread across the country, but most were moved into action in the south and southwest at the time of the floods.
Each high volume pump set can move up to 7,000 litres of water per minute over a distance of up to 3 kilometres. That's the equivalent of emptying or filling an Olympic sized swimming pool of water in about just under 6 hours. The vehicles are absolutely essential in helping to resolve the flooding in the affected areas, also providing reassurance to the public that the fire service were on the ground and moving water to mitigate the effects upon their properties.
As this was such a major operation and virtually unprecedented, the pressure was on.
Okay, all right, what we'll do. I think the greatest test was the deployment throughout the geographical area, from moving the assets from out the whole of the country into the southwest and particularly into the London area as well, and looking at the priorities of those assets into those areas through the Chief Fire and Rescue Advisor.
A report making 44 recommendations was later published, with one clear finding.
I think it's that all fire and rescue services have a very clear and thorough understanding of their role under the National Coordination Advisory Framework, and more importantly, how it could assist them should they become the affected fire and rescue service, as Devon and Somerset was in 2014.
But the report was full of praise too.
It was absolutely the dedication of the personnel. Not just those in the National Resilience Assurance Team, but those through London and also those deployed. The absolute dedication where the personnel worked throughout the whole hours of all the time, fully committed, moving from one operational scene to another. And that total commitment is so highly applaudable.
Fire and rescue officers have returned to a hero's welcome throughout the UK following their harrowing but vital work in the aftermath of Nepal's devastating earthquakes. The UK government deployed a 67-strong international search and rescue team to Kathmandu with 14.5 tonnes of equipment and 4 trained search dogs with their handlers. Well, the situation in Nepal is as extreme as it gets, but the crews were equal to the challenge.
Few of us can forget the images of devastation that followed the earthquake in Nepal earlier this year. Among the many brave people who helped in the aftermath was a 67-strong team from UK International Search and Rescue, or ISAR as it's better known.
We take about 14 tonnes of equipment. That includes all of our rescue equipment, our logistical support equipment, communications and ICT, so that we're fully self-sufficient for a period of up to 14 days. Our team members, they're all cross-trained, so we take firefighters that are urban search and rescue specialists. We also take a medical team of six doctors. We take canines, so we take four search dogs, and then we take all of our logistics and communication experts as well to support the deployment.
Search and rescue!
UK ISAR teams, first established in 1992, are made up of specially trained fire officers from services across the country. This disaster training facility near Lincoln ensures that the teams build and maintain specialist skills that may be needed at a moment's notice. After all, the aim of ISAR is to be mobilised within 6 hours and on the ground within 24 hours, wherever in the world that may be.
It's very, very good because we get all of the hard skills here squared away and everybody is proficient before we deploy overseas. Obviously, as a team, we are assessed every 5 years to make the International United Nations classification. So the hard skills here are squared away before we go. So we know that everybody's at a good standard.
A key element to any rescue mission is specially trained dogs and their handlers. In Nepal, where many buildings were reduced to rubble, the dogs played a critical role in the search operation, despite the challenging climate conditions.
They do sort of acclimatise very quickly, but it's just a point to bear in mind for the handler that if it is very hot, then we just work them for a shorter duration, give them a drink, a short rest, and then we can then work them again. But we've got different equipment that we can have with the dogs. So we've got cooling jackets to sort of maintain their core temperature.
The earthquake in Nepal killed more than 9,000 and injured more than 23,000. But thanks to rescue teams like UK ISAR, many more were saved.
Most of the buildings were completely destroyed, very difficult to carry out rescues within those. But what the team was able to do on this occasion was adapt with the expertise that we've got, and we were actually carrying out a lot of disaster assessments. We also worked on a huge hospital where we made safe. It wasn't physical rescues, but by actually making that hospital safe, we brought four operating theatres and 400 beds back into use, which had huge impacts for the people in Nepal.
While the training facility plays a critical role in preparing for incidents like Nepal, nothing compares to the scale of many disasters, particularly the human cost.
We deal with that in our normal day-to-day job, of course, but it's the scale. Whereas we may have one or two, three casualties at a road traffic collision in the UK, out there we may have 20, 30, 40, 50, 100 casualties to deal with. So that can be very testing.
As testing as such disasters are, UK ISAR met the challenge face on.
We've got some of the most highly trained firefighters and urban search and rescue specialists in the world, and every time we go out, it gives me a huge amount of satisfaction and pride as well in the work that we do.
In spite of relentless efforts to improve firefighter safety in the UK, 14 firefighters have lost their lives fighting fires over the past 10 years. Fire services are always looking for ways to improve job safety, and now they have an impressive new ally. As Nick Wallace reports, Cold Cut Systems technology has proved so effective, it's won over fire crews around the country.
With the right conditions, fire spreads quickly and it burns hot. In an enclosed space, this can present serious dangers to firefighters. That's now changing.
Welcome to the Fire Service College in Gloucestershire, where the firefighters here are being trained on a very special piece of kit. This, the Cold Cut Cobra Extinguisher. Looks impressive, but wait till you see what it does.
The Fire Service College hosts a Cold Cut Cobra Academy, and you're about to see a demonstration of a Cobra in action. First, an experienced firefighter sets light to the sort of furnishings you'd find in a domestic front room. Once the fire's properly taken hold, the doors to the room are shut.
This well-developed fire now presents a serious risk to the firefighters who have to put it out opening the doors could fuel the fire with oxygen, making things even worse.
A traditional attack with standard equipment requires direct access to the source of the fire. Firefighters have to break down a window or door to get the water onto the fire. The Cobra gets round this in spectacular fashion. As soon as the fire crew's on the scene, the incident commander looks for the source of the fire on his thermal imaging camera. Once the most effective entry point has been decided, the Cobra is deployed in dramatic style. The Cobra operator has made it through the door of the house. Now he cuts off the abrasive agent and sends a jet of high-pressure water droplets into the enclosed room. The screen is linked to a thermocouple placed inside the building. Within a few seconds of the Cobra being deployed, the temperature is dropping like a stone. Now with the fire completely under control, the firefighters can make the building safe.
That was a seriously impressive display. Tell me a bit more about this kit. What exactly is coming out of the end of that nozzle?
This is Cobra Lance. It creates a jet of water with a mixture of abrasive, 4% at the nozzle, at 300 bars, leaves the nozzle at 400 miles an hour. The speed at which it leaves the nozzle creates a significant piercing capability that then can deliver a large cloud of water mist into a fire compartment or high temperature environment.
What's the Cobra like to handle?
It's very comfortable to handle. Training is key and critical, as with anything that we use. Operators are trained to adopt a positive stance, take a position against the surface. They're leaning against the surface, so they've got some support. Operate to an operation of two triggers, water and abrasive, with the lance tight against their shoulder, very comfortable.
Watching today's demonstration was the man who runs the Swedish company behind the Cobra.
Because the runoff water from traditional firefighting creates a lot of pollution and environmental damages, as opposed to when using the Cobra Lance, when no runoff water basically comes from the incident.
You can use it outside of a building, through a roof, through a wall, you can put it through a letterbox, or then you can use it internally. And it really is a very adaptable tool you can use in a lot of scenarios. And you can also use it for car fires, you can use it to cut through roller shutter doors. It's got so many applications.
When I first saw this technology in action, I was amazed at the difference it could make with the conditions inside a compartment fire. Primarily, that's where I saw it first. I now recognise that it can be used in lots of different situations. But first and foremost, what struck me is the difference this could make in firefighter safety.
The crews that are using it love it. I mean, we encourage them to use it whenever they can. You go use it as the default. And we're surprising ourselves, I think, with some of the feedback that we're getting back about areas where we weren't expecting Cobra to be effective. It actually is being very effective. And the crews, I think the test would be if we tried to take the Cobra away from the crews, we'd be faced with a riot.
Thermal imaging cameras are helping firefighters understand more about fire behaviour than ever before. In spite of intense heat and confined spaces, these cameras are giving a better and a broader picture of what a fire might do next. Scott Safety's taken thermal imaging a step further with innovative hot and cold spot detection capabilities. Sue Saville reports.
In the fight against potentially fatal fires, technology is providing increased safety and intelligence. Essential equipment for firefighters is now more than just protective clothing and breathing apparatus. It also includes the latest thermal imaging cameras.
You can see full room layouts, you can see furniture, so it makes it quicker, it's safer for firefighters going into rooms, and ultimately safer for members of the public. We can reach that person that much quicker.
To maximise training opportunities, Nottinghamshire Fire and Rescue Service has chosen to use Scott Safety equipment. Their extra capacity air cylinders and advanced thermal imaging cameras are the latest developments in the company's decades-long history of bringing innovation to the industry.
The image is very, very clear, and not only can it identify hot spots, it can look for the cold areas within the rooms. And so the screens are much larger, it's far clearer. We have temperature gauges at the side of the screens now. We have points whereby we can direct the camera at a certain point and it will tell exactly the temperature there on a reading at the side of the screen.
Firefighting has been transformed by kit like this, a thermal imaging camera which acts as a high-tech extra pair of eyes, increasingly relied upon to help save lives.
The images recorded in the fire training house can then be analysed to learn about fire behaviour and arm teams with better information. The thermal imaging camera's hotspot tracker can identify the source of the fire, while the cold spot tracker can find a safer route or help identify the cool gas cylinder of a fallen firefighter.
So now the camera is looking for the coldest spot of the scene. This is very important for a firefighter, especially if there is any gas leakage. Or if he's looking for a zone of protection. On a freeze frame, you can apply a hotspot, so you're going to have the information about the temperature of the camera, and you also can apply a cold spot. So this is a very interesting tool when you don't want to be in danger, when you want, for example, just to look at the situation and come back to your teammate and share the ideas and say and ask your teammate what is the best decision to take.
As regards training, they've made a massive difference for us to be able to keep the people safe and make the conditions even more realistic for the training for the firefighters to undertake.
Firefighters themselves are coming up with ideas for further technological developments.
We've discussed as an organisation the ability to link cameras together to then feed back into one central location, so people remote from the incident outside in a command hub, something like that, would be able to actually get eyes on what the guys are doing inside.
Scott Safety is listening, feeding these ideas into its product development. Working closely with fire brigades is a key part of the company's drive for innovation.
It really is a partnership. There's an element of it that is coming from just listening and understanding and you know, coming to places like this, a training centre, and seeing how the equipment is being used and what the challenges are and how the, you know, how the firefighters want to deploy the equipment. But also then it's our job to go away and find out what other technologies are available. It'd probably be a bit premature for me to give away all of the secrets from our engineers, but it's definitely going to be an exciting 2016 for us.
With ideas that will integrate a variety of sensory inputs, firefighters will have greater awareness of their surroundings, and that means staying out of danger for longer. Technology and years of company expertise are finding solutions to the changing needs of the firefighting industry.
To protect firefighters from extremes of heat and flames, scientists have delved ever deeper into the tiny fibres that make up their protective fabrics and clothing. This report from Geneva, where science company DuPont develops and rigorously tests life-saving materials.
Over the past decade, fire services have focused on prevention work, meaning a continuing downward trend in fires attended. But firefighters such as these in Geneva may still be called upon to deal with a range of emergencies.
With the role continuing to adapt, firefighters' turnout gear needs to be versatile. They need protection from fires, of course, but the fabric also needs to meet other needs, such as when they're standing outside for hours on end in the heat at a road traffic collision or a rescue operation.
Alors oui, on se sent complètement protégé avec nos tenues de feu. Sur les interventions feu, on est bien sûr très bien protégé contre la chaleur. Et puis sur d'autres types d'interventions, on se sent protégé contre les différentes contraintes mécaniques que nous demandons à nos équipements de protection individuelle.
These firefighters' protective clothing is made from fabric containing DuPont fibres, Kevlar and Nomex, two innovative fibres which complement each other to create highly effective protection. Nomex offers a range of benefits to meet their needs, adapting to their requirements as well as being heat and flame resistant. What's more, Nomex helps manufacturers make firefighter apparel more comfortable and durable. In fact, Nomex fabrics have very high abrasion resistance and do not degrade over time. They keep the highest level of protection over the lifespan of the garment. Kevlar adds high mechanical strength to make lightweight, resistant fabrics.
When there is a heat impact, Nomex goes through a transformation. And what happens is that Nomex sacrifices itself or uses up the heat energy. It swells. There is an increased barrier formed by the molecules, by the fiber, which creates critical extra seconds for firefighters to escape.
DuPont engages with all parties involved in the production of fabric and uniforms, the weavers, garment makers, and crucially, the fire brigades.
the name of the game in innovation in that, you know, part of the market is to be very, very close to the end users. So we work with all leading fire departments in the region. We've got former firefighters, you know, in the team, in our application teams, working alongside our chemists and engineers. And that's what it takes to, you know, stay on the, you know, leading edge of innovations.
We work with the garment manufacturers and with fire brigades and consortium groups within fire brigades to produce a garment or a system that fits exactly what the fire brigade want.
DuPont also provides first-rate technical support. Meet Marco. There's a very good reason he's wearing protective clothing himself. He's at the controls of Thermoman, this life-size mannequin system, which is one of the most advanced thermal burn injury evaluation devices in the world. This mobile test lab puts garments through a fire scenario that simulates a worst-case flashover at up to 1,000 degrees Celsius. This test demonstrates how Nomex swells, takes up heat energy and keeps it away from the wearer to provide him extra seconds of protection to safely escape.
The test will show you know, thermal properties, durability, strength, heat stress potential of garments and fabrics.
Watching Thermoman in action for the first time can be a sobering experience, but the all-important test results displayed on Marco's screen help to design and improve the quality of the garments.
We finally test the gear on our Thermoman facilities. We have these facilities in the US, we have them in Europe, and we have them in Asia, so we can support firefighters all across the globe.
From innovative fibers to cutting-edge technical support, DuPont is helping protect firefighters all around the world and helping them meet the demands of a rigorous and challenging job.
Every year, there are nearly 600 fires in UK warehouses that are not fitted with sprinklers. Large fires like these lead to massive financial and job losses. Well, the sprinkler industry is questioning the strength of the current warehouse regulations, which are leaving many commercial premises unprotected from an effective first line of defence.
When firefighters are called to a blaze at a warehouse, saving the building and what's inside can be shaped by the response before they arrive.
Sprinklers help to contain a blaze many minutes before fire crews like this one can get to it.
But every year, almost 600 fires occur in warehouses which simply don't have them.
Those minutes lost can have huge repercussions for business, according to research commissioned by the Business Sprinkler Alliance, which estimates that direct losses alone are more than £230 million a year, and some companies never recover. That means almost 400 jobs are lost directly each year, and more than 600 others within their supply chains.
These knock-on effects are among the concerns highlighted by the report into the financial and economic impact of warehouse fires. In Britain, only warehouses greater than 20,000 square feet are legally required to have sprinklers fitted. In much of Europe, the rules are much tighter. The report suggests warehouse developers work more closely with future tenants to weigh up the potential benefits versus costs, but changes in legislation may also be needed. After all, fires of this type cost the Exchequer money as well, almost £32 million each year in lost taxation.
You can't smell it, you can't see it, but carbon monoxide can creep up on us in our homes. Every year in the UK, there are about 40 deaths from carbon monoxide poisoning, and more than 200 people are admitted to hospital. Technology company Honeywell, makers of carbon monoxide alarms, is raising awareness of this silent killer.
Hey, Jill Emerson knows how lucky she is to be alive. Last winter, she was at home alone in Oxfordshire with her dog Alfie when her carbon monoxide alarm went off.
I had been suffering from headaches for nearly 3 weeks, and one morning I got up, put the heating on, came through into the kitchen, and the carbon monoxide alarm went off. And so I got the alarm down, did what it said inside the alarm, rang the number, and within an hour someone had come up and basically condemned the boiler. When he put his instrument over it, he said he doesn't know how we're still alive.
So where was the alarm positioned when you had the issue?
Carbon monoxide was being emitted from Jill's previous boiler. Had it not been for her alarm, the mother of three would have died.
They could have been burying their mum, so I just feel so blessed and so glad that I had that alarm.
Carbon monoxide is often referred to as the silent killer. It's colourless, odourless and tasteless. Symptoms are similar to those of flu, from mild headaches, dizziness and nausea, but high concentrations can be fatal.
Very, very simple to operate. You just clip the back plate on like so. That is now locked into place, completely sealed. In order to test the unit, you just simply press the test button. And with this unit, you also get an action text message giving the user a clear indication of what to do in the event of an alarm, which is important.
Carbon monoxide poisoning can occur at any time, in any residential home or confined space. Having an early warning system in place is vital. Poole-based Honeywell has been manufacturing gas detection equipment for more than 50 years.
These are life-saving devices, and carbon monoxide is a very dangerous gas. It's odourless, colourless, tasteless, so there's no real means of detecting it other than by means of a carbon monoxide detector. And it can be released from any fuel-burning appliance.
Every year in the UK, more than 40 people die from carbon monoxide poisoning. But how much do the public know about this deadly gas?
I think it's absolutely critical to have one, because you just never know. It's obviously a silent killer.
I have two. One downstairs where the boiler is in the kitchen, another one where the gas fire is upstairs.
We have a smoke alarm on both landing and ground floor, but we don't have carbon monoxide knowledge, if you will. It's just lack of knowledge.
These alarms take less than a minute to fit, yet just 47% of private households have one installed. That's despite the fact that 88% of us know that you can't smell carbon monoxide. I gave Honeywell consultant Brett Skelton a tour around my own home, a standard residential property, to see where the carbon monoxide alarms should be placed.
In the kitchen situation, I recommend that you put a detector up here, away from the doors and windows, because they can be affected by drafts. Right, do you keep any vehicles in the garage?
No.
OK, well, in this situation, I'd recommend that you put a detector on the wall over there. Right, well, the best place to put the carbon monoxide alarm here would be around about 3 metres away from the fire.
So this is the master bedroom above the garage, okay, where the boiler is. What would you recommend?
If the alarm in the garage went off, the likelihood is you wouldn't hear it. I'd recommend that we put a carbon monoxide alarm by the side of the bed. That way, if there is any carbon monoxide, which can get up here, it's going to alert you and get you out of the house. It's critical to have an alarm, but it's just as important to install the alarm in the correct place. It should never be by an open door, a window or an air brick. It should never be located above the appliance. It should always be between 1 and 3 metres away from the appliance. And we always recommend that you read the manufacturer's instruction book, which comes with your unit.
Honeywell carbon monoxide alarm saved my life, without a doubt. I wouldn't be here if I hadn't had it.
Honeywell were the first to introduce carbon monoxide alarms in the UK. Having a high quality one correctly fitted in the right location could keep us safe from this silent killer.
Decades of promoting the prevention message have paid off, with fire calls dropping significantly over the last 10 years. But community trust is as high as ever, and fire officers are in a unique position to protect the most vulnerable in society. This story from Cheshire Fire and Rescue explains how a simple home fire safety check can help save lives.
Hello, Beryl.
Hello.
Hello there, my name's Dave, I'm from the fire service.
Yeah. Cheshire Fire and Rescue Service is giving Beryl a free home safety check. She'd booked an appointment before, but it didn't quite go to plan.
Beryl was collapsed in a bedroom by the door.
Oh, heavens above.
And they helped me to assess her and find out what was going on.
The fire service targeted Beryl because it's working with the NHS and social care providers to share data about homes with vulnerable people. There are currently 10 million over 65s in Britain, and by 2050, the government estimates that number will have almost doubled.
The secret is getting to the right people in the community where you can make the most difference. And that's where using intelligence and data is so important.
And by working in partnership with organisations like the NHS, Cheshire Fire and Rescue Service can offer vulnerable people like Beryl much more than fire safety precautions.
So obviously if we see someone who's, you know, quite clearly struggling in the home, we can involve other agencies. Again, it's with, you know, the consent of the homeowner. One of the main agencies that we do work with is Age UK.
A lot of people will say the visit changed their lives because it put in chain an event beyond the fire service person, because we're working with people like Age UK and people in the health service, in terms of support and stability to make them independent and safer in their own homes.
A proactive approach reducing risks to improve the lives of vulnerable people.
Now, because fire officers are in a unique position to enter people's homes, they have increasingly become invaluable partners to social care services. We joined a special community risk intervention team in Manchester to see how fire officers are improving care and reducing emergency call-outs.
Adrian and Jodie are on a house call with a difference. They've come to fit a grab rail in Susan Green's bathroom.
I was a bit surprised, really. You know, I thought, oh, how come the fire service have got involved?
Adrian is a fully trained firefighter, but he's part of the community risk intervention team. It's a partnership between Manchester's emergency services, health providers and councils. As well as tackling today's task, the teams also act as first responders.
Must be quite a departure from the day job, though.
Yeah, not. It's a different kind of role, you know, it's all tied in together and all part of the service.
And while Adrian's busy upstairs fitting the grab rail, his colleague is downstairs carrying out a home safety check, making sure that things like the smoke alarm still works, and offering advice about possibly replacing these polystyrene tiles. Today's visit is all about preventing an accident, but what happens if there's already been one?
There's a gentleman went into hospital on the Friday evening, and on the Saturday the community risk intervention team went back to his home, reabled his home, put handrails and some other equipment around there, and on the Sunday the gentleman was back home again.
In the past that process could have taken weeks, so acting quickly helped the patient and saved the NHS money. It's just another one of the ways community risk intervention teams are helping to improve care and reduce emergency call-outs, at the same time as maximising fire service resources.
And shortly, more action as we venture behind the scenes at the UK's world-leading training college.
This facility is incredibly important for the way that we train and develop our firefighters.
Firefighters go through incident command training in case of an airport emergency. And our crew gets the inside story as breathing apparatus is put through its paces. Fire and rescue services are responding to an ever-widening range of emergencies, from house and chemical fires to car accidents, drownings and international disasters. They literally have to be ready for anything. So Paul Brennan visited the world-class Waddington training site in Lincolnshire to see just how prepared they are.
A speedy and effective response by the emergency services to a vehicle collision at a level crossing. Thankfully, this is not a real-life event, but a simulation exercise at the Waddington Fire and Rescue Training Site in Lincolnshire.
This facility is incredibly important for the way that we train and develop our firefighters. Today, and as with every other day, we're ready to respond to a range of incidents, anything from a road traffic collision to, for example, a train derailment. This facility gives us the opportunity to simulate a range of those incidents so that people are actually training on a day-to-day basis in an environment that actually reflects the kind of training and operational delivery that we need to develop.
A critical part of any blue light response is how well the emergency services work together. This facility offers a multi-agency learning experience.
Many, many years ago, we used to assess people pretty much on their practical elements. Nowadays, we look far more at their decision-making processes, so why they make choices, why they make decisions, and how they've made those decisions. And that's what we're looking at, because we get a rounded, better view of that individual. And that also works on a multi-agency level, which is how we've had to evolve. We're not only a fire and rescue service, we work in a multi-agency emergency service.
Charlie Whiskey 111, we're mobilising you as incident commander to a four-pump industrial unit fire.
The new command control centre at Waddington enables those across the emergency services who jointly lead live incidents greater coordination, shared information and, critically, speedier assessment and response.
Well received, sir. Echo Charlie out.
Our high-level commanders can get together and practice those skill sets that high-level commanders require to training, which then allows us to have simultaneous activity between the live things which are being delivered on the fire ground or the incident ground, all the way through to the command and control, which allows us to operate at all the levels that you'd expect, ranging from the immediate response all the way through to protracted incidents.
It doesn't take the resources as we would have had before on the fire ground. We're able to do minimal resources, but equally get just as much of the learning points and development areas from that as we would with a 10 or 15 pump incident.
Fire service duties extend far and wide, from fires and road accidents to chemical spills and water-based emergencies. All of these need regular, practical and rigorous training.
Contact!
It's very important to develop these real-life scenarios because they're realistic to what we're likely to do out in the real world. The skills that we develop here relate to our own competencies, and the repetition of doing that creates skills that we'll be able to carry out, like I said, into the real world.
Thankfully, fire and rescue services have become quieter. We don't have as many property fires as we used to. Sadly, we still do have a high number of road traffic collisions. So clearly, with a decrease in the number of calls, we do need to keep our skills up and be able to train and get ready for when those incidents do occur.
As needs and demands evolve, so does the training to ensure that the emergency services are ready to respond swiftly and effectively, whatever that need may be.
Lovely. Excellent.
Acting quickly and effectively is critical when there is a fire emergency. And at an airport, there needs to be a constant state of readiness and a clear line of command. Serco's International Fire Training Centre has the resources and the expertise to specialise in incident command training. Jonathan Gibson has more.
A fire has broken out in the body of this Boeing 747, and I'm inside the cabin where it's spreading fast. Today, this is just a rehearsal, but every year, firefighters from around the world come to IFTC, the International Fire Training Centre, to practice real-life scenarios like this one.
We've got the organisation on the incident ground, and what we need there is a clear line of command.
At its base next to Durham Tees Valley Airport, these fire officers are learning the importance of incident command.
Fire command tower, affirm all vehicles in position.
When an aircraft is on fire, the right response saves lives. That's why incident command training is so important.
So, Paul, en route to the incident, what are the factors do you need to consider?
Well, I'm considering the passengers, obviously. They're my first priority.
Inside IFTC's virtual reality suite, these fire officers are responding to a developing incident in real time. There's a fire on board an Airbus A380, which has landed with 320 passengers. Under the watchful eye of tutors, it's up to the incident commander to take control.
The virtual reality suite enables delegates to rehearse their complete emergency response from initial report through to conclusion.
Media at this moment is foam down to 20%.
They find it very realistic. They find it very involving. We've got multiple aircraft scenarios, but on top of that, we can also throw in certainly different degrees of difficulty into the simulation. We can have variable times of day or night. We can have variable weather conditions. And also the resources that become or made available, we can dictate what that's going to be.
The virtual reality suite is a fantastic addition to this training establishment, because you can run that scenario on a virtual basis, stop, start, and therefore as a customer I can request that IFTC set a particular programme of incident scenarios, areas which I particularly want to test. It's very valuable in developing firefighters and your firefighter leaders of the future.
But it's out of the classroom and back here on the fire ground that those skills are really put to the test. And this is one of the best facilities of its kind anywhere in the world.
Today, firefighters from Durham Tees Valley Airport are being put through their paces. In this scenario, a Boeing 767 has caught fire during maintenance.
Fire Commander Tower, Roger, zero category for airfield.
But as well as a fire to deal with, there are casualties on board.
How important is this type of training?
Very important, otherwise we can't practice on real aircraft. So this gives us an ideal opportunity to practice on pressurised fuel fires, engine fires, undercarriage, internal fires safely, and so we can practice our tactics and techniques.
So firefighters come from all around the world to train every 4 years, and we have this on our doorstep.
People aren't going to travel here like they do now from Vancouver, from Hong Kong, from Algeria, other locations, if we don't have some of the best equipment and some of the best tutors available. These guys are expert, not just in firefighting, but actually in training. So day in, day out, they're working with people, different levels of expertise, different cultures, different backgrounds, and making sure that the training is delivered in a way that's very easy for the delegates to absorb, understand. So when they go back to their place of work, they've got the knowledge and perhaps above all the confidence to tackle an incident if an emergency were to happen.
With fire and rescue services having to respond in an instant, it is important that emergency calls are processed quickly and effectively. Intergraph's ICAD software is used by Northwest Fire Control to provide call answering and mobilising services. Our reporter visited their Warrington Control Centre to find out how it works.
Fire and Rescue Service, what's your address of the emergency?
Can you hurry up, please? My car is just set on fire.
Right, your car's on fire. Right, it's okay. Yeah. Calm down. What's your address?
I'm on Kenilworth Road in Runcorn.
An emergency call and time is of the essence. Using the Intergraph computer-aided dispatch system, Northwest Fire Control can send the closest and most appropriate fire crew to the scene. This system has quite literally enabled four separate fire and rescue services to combine operation resources under one roof.
It has broken down those fire service borders so we can get resources to incidents far more quicker than we ever have been able to. We're able to locate the caller and the incident more quickly and efficiently than we have done before. And we're able to send the right resources to the right location very, very quickly now.
Okay, guys, vehicle fire, Kenilworth Avenue.
While the system shows the location of all resources and their status, interactive mobile software in the vehicles feeds information between the control centre and the crews. This ensures a much smoother, integrated response.
And the way we work out which is the best crew to send is by knowing where everybody is all of the time and what their status is. We are tracking them on the map using GPS and working out what their ETA is to get to the incident.
Prior to Northwest Fire Control going live in May 2014, each of the four fire and rescue services was operating and funding its own systems and facilities.
So what this has done is allowed them to share that cost, to review the staffing model and review the rota patterns that people work, to operate a more demand-led rostering system, which means that we have the right people on duty at the right time to manage that call demand.
It's extremely good value for money. But then after that, it's future-proof. So it means that some of the stuff that we've used in the past, including Greater Manchester, for instance, was very old technology, couldn't respond in the way that we can nowadays. And not to do it is letting the public of our region down.
From an emergency response point of view, we're now able to pinpoint exactly where our incidents are, which is all to do with the technology that is held in Northwest Fire Control. This means that our response times are obviously quicker, and we can have a more detailed approach to the way we tackle the incidents en route.
The system is tailored to the needs of each of the services it supports.
Well, every customer is different, and we work with them through a series of workshops, familiarisation, so they can learn what's possible, and then workshops to determine how to tailor that to their particular workflows.
What's more, the Intergraph system can be adapted to multi-agency use.
We have buddy arrangements with Staffordshire and West Midlands Control Room and also London Fire Brigade Control Room. So it adds us some more resilience, and it also enables us to assist each other in the event that there is a large incident or there are large volumes of calls that need to overflow into a different location.
At its simplest, government targets are about having less money to do what life's about in firefighting terms. And if we hadn't done this, we'd have been shutting fire stations, taking pumps off the run. And with a choice like that, it's so obvious that we have to do it. And we were very comfortable doing it because it was right for the public, but also for that public purse.
All right, the fire service are on the way. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
New technologies are vital to deliver greater safety for firefighters and our communities, as well as delivering efficiencies to hard-pushed fire services. Leading technology company Draeger is working in partnership with Scottish fire crews to introduce innovative technologies alongside their breathing apparatus. Our reporter Julie McDonald got the inside story as firefighters put the new kit through its paces.
OK, guys, what we're doing here, we're going into the tie box, which is an underventilated compartment. We will be going in twos.
This is the attack box. Temperatures reach 1,000 degrees centigrade in here, and Draeger technology helps the fire crews to brave these dangerous conditions. Like firefighters across Great Britain, these crews from the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service are fighting fewer fires than a decade ago, but the dangers they face are still huge.
The number of fires that firefighters are actually exposed to is dropping year on year, which is a great result for the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service. However, it means that they're not getting the operational exposure that they used to. Now, the incorporation of technology into the training that's delivered allows us to deliver realistic training, which allows their experience levels to be increased in a simulated environment.
New technology is a firefighter's lifeline, and Draeger, the global company that provides their breathing apparatus, is passionate about the safety of fire crews across Britain.
It's critical to understand that the firefighters, they have to trust the equipment that they're using. What we've seen is that it's as much about communication at the incident as it is about the respiratory protection itself. The inter-firefighter communication is really important as well, and improving that, not just back to the command at the scene, but also between firefighters, makes a big difference in terms of how they can respond effectively and safely to an incident.
In a hostile fire situation like this, a firefighter's best weapon and safety net is effective communications.
This is an FPS COM 7000, a mask that allows fire crews to communicate clearly with one another. It's wireless and allows the crews to be hands-free so that they can concentrate on the main job of putting out the fire.
Before now, communicating whilst wearing breathing apparatus proved a major challenge to all fire services. In the past, cables connecting to crew radios presented a snagging hazard and couldn't always withstand the heat. These innovative wireless communications are a game changer, filtering out breathing noise and with no buttons to press or cables.
What it tended to be was using radios, using communications, so with the breathing apparatus on, the messages back to entry control and such tended to be pretty unreadable at times. But what we've found with this is that we can talk to each other at a normal pace, at a normal volume. But it helps you feel more confident with you and your BA team that you're communicating with each other properly. It ensures that you'll never be split up from your BA partner, and that alone would make you feel safer.
And the crews here say they trust the equipment because they've had a say in how it's designed.
The last thing you want to be thinking about is comfort, and
if his set's fitted correctly. So the PSS 7000 features a lot of configuration options. So there's a lot of time and investment spent listening to the firefighters, working with brigades worldwide, but a lot in the UK as well. And all of that information is fed into the product.
The brigades here make up part of Scotland's Fire and Rescue Service, which saw eight services merging together. Brigade safety and training for the 8,500 firefighters is key, and so working with a manufacturer who could also act as a partner and, crucially, who understood the reality on the ground was vital.
For 20 years now we've been working, and some of the services across Scotland have been working with Dräger for that time now. So we have built up that relationship, and Dräger have built up their knowledge of the Fire and Rescue Service. They know how we do our job, they know what we are trying to achieve out there in our communities. So it is that personal relationship that we have. It's more of a partnership than we have of that traditional customer-supplier relationship.
Innovative wireless communications equipment alongside telemetry, a system that allows incident command to remotely monitor a firefighter's breathing rates and which can send a series of radio-transmitted alarms if a firefighter becomes hurt or unconscious, are amongst the newest innovations in Dräger technology. Taking one further step towards making our great British fire crews, their colleagues and communities across the globe safer and more effective on the job.
A firefighter's protective clothing has changed to meet the needs of modern fire and rescue services. Hainsworth Technology develops fabrics designed to minimise the risks from fire, oil and chemicals. Toby Sadler reports now on how this important fabric is produced.
These are fabrics designed to save lives. That protection is woven in. The very structure of the cloth makes it lightweight, breathable and flexible. The main purpose of that is to reduce the risk of heat stress on firefighters. It's the latest evolution in a process that started with the King's Cross fire disaster in 1987. The crews working in the extreme heat underground were left exposed and actually hindered by their uniforms. Since then, Hainsworth Technology has worked tirelessly to make sure firefighters are properly equipped. It is a testament to that process that sees the London Fire Brigade wearing its Titan range today, along with fire services worldwide.
Our team actually spend their time talking to firefighters, experiencing what it means to be a modern-day firefighter, carry out hot box training, testing the kit, going to the fire, seeing how it works. That relationship is absolutely key, because unless you have a bit of experience of it, you can't then translate that into what it means for fabric technology that supports our garment makers.
Hainsworth buys in fibres to make its fabric, then sells the cloth to manufacturers. It is a supply chain built on trust, but the mill doesn't expect buyers to simply take its word on quality.
We have our own independent testing lab on site, and at each process throughout the making of our fabric, we have quality control, which is systemic to our production. And we always are reviewing and rechecking and making sure that the end product that our garment maker gets, and then therefore the end customer gets, is the best quality that we can provide.
The physical demands on these fabrics are high. An ability to repel both water and toxic chemicals is key for firefighters. That protection is achieved with a special coating. It's then checked in Hainsworth's laboratory. The gutter test puts a variety of strong chemicals onto the fabric. The law says 80% must run off. But here they consistently get results well up into the 90s.
Well, it's got to be reassuring for the firefighters that we're doing these tests, that we are checking every single batch, because you know, you only need one run to be faulty, and it could be someone's life on the line.
Of course, these materials must also protect against a flash fire. That's temperatures up to 500 degrees Celsius for up to 25 seconds. This is the Titan cloth experiencing that in the lab.
We have a Nomex face and a Kevlar back. And when the sample's been exposed, the Nomex chars, which absorbs the heat energy, and the Kevlar on the back remains intact. And because the face and the back work so differently, the fabric ripples and creates air pockets. And these air pockets give us an extra thermal barrier, which is all essential to extra safety for the firefighter.
Hainsworth makes a variety of protective fabrics. Different fibres are used to offer greater choice for firefighters. But whichever they go for, the safety of the wearer is always top of the list.
This jacket demonstrates just how effective these fabrics are. It's been burnt in a laboratory. You can see really how severely charred it is on the outside. Compare that to the new one behind me. But look at the inside. Look at the lining. This is the critical part. It's almost unscathed. And that's where the firefighter's life is going to be saved. It's going to give them critical extra seconds to get out of a fire and get to safety.
Hainsworth has been making fabrics since 1783. Is rightly proud of its pedigree, but far from complacent. So as the roles of the firefighters change, this company remains adamant it too will continue to evolve and innovate, making sure that those that protect us get the best possible protection.
Coming up on Beyond Blue Lights, part-time firefighters are forced to be reckoned with. Specialist software monitors crewing capability. And control room technology keeps track of staffing levels. It is certainly good news that firefighters are experiencing extreme situations less frequently than ever before, but the changing face of firefighting in the UK means that practical training for crews is becoming more important. Crofton Engineering has a long history of working with emergency services, building bespoke structures and fire simulators. And as Robin Ross discovered, there is plenty of realism to keep fire crews at the top of their game.
Feeling the pressure, officers from Cambridgeshire Fire and Rescue Service are practicing a rescue drill at their bespoke training centre in Milton.
The venue's top class. We can use it for live fires. We can use it for a flat, for a house. We've got a pitched roof, so we can use that for ladder drills. We've also got a tower that we can use with three stories, so we can use that for working at height exercises.
This training facility was designed and built by Crofton Engineering. They specialise in designing bespoke structures for the emergency services. As budget cuts continue to bite, adaptable and affordable training is more important than ever.
I need to provide cutting-edge training facilities that meet their need, training facilities that are fit for the future, and training facilities that we can adapt so that we can continue, no matter how far the budget gets stripped out, to make sure that the firefighters we're sending to incidents are well prepared and capable of dealing with those incidents.
We design, manufacture bespoke training buildings for the emergency services. So everything from standard rope rescue towers, ladder practice towers, safe working at height structures, confined space structures, smoke buildings, cold and hot smoke, carbonaceous simulators and LPG fired simulators.
Crofton Engineering employs people from within the fire service. Andy Barker had a 30-year career at Greater Manchester Fire and Rescue Service, specialising in safe work at heights. He brings his years of experience and knowledge to the design process.
It could be that they want a window cleaning cradle on the side of a tower, or they just want to do basic safe work at height, so we'll open the structure out and just allow them to climb on the structure, put some extra anchor points in, make some holes in the floor so they can go up and down ropes, simulate sewer rescues.
The total number of fires attended in 2013-14 was 212,500. That's down by 40% in the last 10 years, thanks to fire prevention. So officers are attending fewer fires.
At 3 o'clock in the morning, it's one chance. And that's what training, real modern training, is about. The training props, their buildings, their structures, the sort of thing that Crofton designs and manufactures in collaboration with fire brigades.
We can have movable walls, we can have doors open both ways. So when an instructor comes along from fire service, they can come in and say, right, today we're going to do a left-hand search or a right-hand search. We'd like to keep it fresh every time.
This building has really been built to test firefighters. It's like a room within a room. And when it's filled with smoke, it's very easy to miss something. Like this ladder here that leads up to the attic, where the casualty could be.
During training, the crew are called to attend a report of a light aircraft crash. Training must reflect all types of emergencies.
With some of the major disasters that we've had since 9/11 and 7/7, a lot of emphasis has been placed on urban search and rescue. So we've designed a range of buildings for the guys to practice those types of techniques. So they'll put a casualty in a confined space with a lot of obstacles in their way.
We want to build something that's going to last us, that's reasonably priced and flexible, that we can change for the future.
Crofton Engineering made its name building training structures. This is their very first tower, built in 1958 to train crew at Linton and Cambridgeshire, and it's still going strong. All these structures give firefighters extra confidence.
Without that sort of training facility, we couldn't do our jobs, really. To maintain the level of competence firefighters need, to be able to train every day, is of paramount importance to us. You know, there's no way we could fulfil our roles without having that. So yeah, it's vital for us.
It is not always possible to maintain a full-time firefighting capability in rural or lower-risk areas. So how do brigades ensure that they have the crewing capability for emergency situations? Well, the answer is a highly skilled retained force that lives within close range of their local fire station. Paul Brennan reports on a day in the life of an on-call firefighter.
Charlotte Anderson works in customer services, but for the last 4 years has been a retained firefighter at Shepton Mallet, and it's a job she loves.
When I first wanted to become a firefighter, I had an admin job in my normal employment, but externally I was very active and I wanted a job that could incorporate the both, and as well I really liked the family idea and the family environment and camaraderie that you get with the fire service.
There are 19,000 retained or on-call firefighters across the UK, compared to over 32,000 whole-time. While they may carry out the same incident duties, is there a two-tier service?
The training for retained firefighters is exactly the same as whole-time firefighters, same standard. The way in which that's delivered, however, is sometimes very different. And it will depend on the individual and the amount of time that they're able to put into that training programme. But on average, retained firefighters will spend 2 hours a week training and enhancing and maintaining those skills. But in addition to that, they will do exactly the same training courses as other firefighters.
Obviously, I work at our retained station, but I've had opportunity to go and integrate with whole-time stations as well. We work hand-in-hand and are very supportive of each other. On the incident ground, we work together as crewmen. Externally, for training and development, we might all get together as well. So it's very integrated service.
While Charlotte may be an on-call firefighter, there's nothing part-time in her commitment or, indeed, her career progression.
Although I've only been in 4 years, I've had a real quick career progression from firefighter. Brilliant exposure, brilliant training and development through that, and I've progressed quite quickly onto a crew manager role, which is more responsibility, more admin involvement, able to deliver training packages, and as well more responsibility on the fire ground in terms of planning and organisation at incidents. Hiya, Paul.
Hello.
Just going through my development folder, and just wondered if you could give me a hand with one of the questions.
Okay.
An on-call firefighter costs around a tenth of the amount of a whole-time firefighter, as they're only paid for when needed. So how does the fire service respond to criticism by some that it's fire cover on the cheap?
Although it's more efficient, we still need a blended approach. So essentially you need your whole-time firefighters in areas where you're very, very busy operationally. But in areas where you're less busy, on-call firefighters is a very cost-effective way of delivering a service. But in truth, there is no distinction operationally between the roles that we expect firefighters to undertake, and it's important, therefore, we've got a blended approach.
You have to have a lot of passion for it. It has to come from the heart completely, your enthusiasm to do the job. It's very supportive, and even as a retained fire staff, I feel very respected and valued by the service.
On-call firefighters are absolutely essential to the way in which a modern fire and rescue service runs. It's a very cost-effective model. It provides all sorts of opportunities to the individual, to their employers, and to the fire and rescue service that's having to deal with significant financial pressures. However, the most important point is that there is no distinction made between whole-time firefighters and retained firefighters in operational terms. They are trained to the same standard and they do an exceptional job, and I'm very proud of both my whole-time and my retained firefighters.
Now, whether you're relying on part-time, full-time or even volunteer staff, it is important to know that you have the right people available when responding to emergencies. Garton Technologies has developed specialist software that flags understaffing issues and finds available cover when the heat is on. Joanna Simpson reports.
Lee Church House is one of roughly 18,000 on-call or retained firefighters who make up a vital part of the fire service. He has a day job in Bicester, but once that's finished, checks in via his mobile phone to show he's now available to be called in. The fire service says retained firefighters help provide efficient and reliable cover across 60% of the UK. Being able to use the Garton Technologies app to manage when he's available is saving Lee a lot of valuable time.
Yeah, Garton saved me probably about half an hour a day. The fact is I don't need to drive down here to book unavailable to go to work or to book back available when I've come back from work. And also phone calls if the appliances are going to be made unavailable or I go sick. I can do all that from home.
The status of the vehicles at Lee's station comes in here to the Thames Valley Control Room, which monitors the availability of vehicles crewed by both whole-time and retained personnel in Oxfordshire and Buckinghamshire.
It's critical information coming into the control room is accurate. Operators need to know exactly when and where retained firefighters are available. They can then effectively deploy them along with vehicles when the emergency call comes in.
Here, the white box means the fire engine pump is available to deploy. Red means there are too few staff and it's not available. And yellow shows a specialist appliance, such as a water carrier, can be sent out. The online system Garton means the control room staff can see who is available in real time, but they can also address in advance any gaps in cover.
That allows us to plan then for any gaps that we have in the fire cover, etc. So say for instance if we've an area within that county that hasn't got sufficient resources, that allows Thames Valley then to pinpoint those resources or those areas where we need to cover.
When the crew is alerted, they arrive at their station and can immediately see who will be responding to the call-out and what specialist qualifications they have.
And how do you think this system has impacted your efficiency?
I think we've seen a significant improvement. We know precisely when the pumps are available and we know the competencies of the crews on those pumps, so we can mobilise the right pump at the right time to the right incident.
The Garton software has two modules, which is also useful for full or whole-time firefighters, who, as well as seeing their shift pattern, use it to manage their leave, overtime and other administration requests.
Because I'm contracted to be here till 9:30 at night, it actually tells me that I shouldn't be coming into work till 12. So, and also if I'm at home and I've got leave available, I can go on to a smartphone, any tablet or any computer, and I can book leave from home and it's authorised and I can take a day off at short notice if I need it. So it's very flexible and very easy to use, yeah.
Garton says it has an innovative software solution and it values the organisations it works with. It licenses its software so clients such as the fire service can add bespoke elements to address their changing requirements. They also receive free system upgrades. This, it says, keeps the system as relevant now as it was in year one.
The main benefits is it brings a sense of control to the organisation. It brings a sense of efficiency. And they are designed in a way to bring in the end user. It's all about the end user. It's all about providing them with the tools to manage their time. So the message that, you know, that sends out to the end user is that the organisation really values and appreciates what they do by providing them with the very best tools.
Accuracy and ease of use are the key factors, but it's the speed and reliability of this system for the fire service that is potentially helping save lives across the country.
As technology becomes smaller and more affordable, there are new high-tech opportunities to make firefighters' jobs safer. New technology from FLIR Systems is putting thermal imaging cameras in closer reach of firefighters. This report now from Staffordshire Fire and Rescue Training Centre.
When faced with fire, you need a cool head in the heat of the moment. and a means to visualise quickly how best to respond. For most fire services, thermal imaging cameras, or TICs as they're known, are now an essential part of the kit, helping their crews to identify hotspots and keeping them safe in some of the darkest and smokiest environments.
We like things that are straightforward because, see, when everything's cracking off at an incident, you want something that you can pick up, grab, switch on, and it's working for you straight away.
They are essential for compartment firefighting, casualty rescue, firefighter safety. They are a fantastic tool.
Even when entering a smoke-filled room, visibility can drop within seconds, but a thermal imaging camera can act as a second pair of eyes.
Have you got a casualty, Dan?
Fleur is one of the biggest manufacturers of these handheld ticks, and its affordable K-series offers clear images and temperature displays in real time.
The K-series of cameras is designed to support firefighters to do their jobs efficiently and effectively, and to save lives as well as protect their own.
And the cameras have been rigorously tested to withstand the toughest operating conditions.
We have had a lot of discussions with fire brigades, how they use it, how they control it, and we have really come up with an extremely simple, easy to use product that is totally intuitive, so the training should be at minimum.
And the newest models in the K-series also have in-camera recording for stills and video, which can be useful for later analysis and training purposes.
They speed up the times for search and rescue, so we're locating casualties far faster. They also enable us to find the seat of the fire far quicker. The added benefit of these cameras is they record all the data that we've seen firsthand, which means when we're trying to debrief or brief somebody about a compartment, they can actually see where they're going or what we've been doing, which is invaluable.
In the past, the price of ticks more generally has limited the numbers of cameras each fire service could afford. But the Fleur range now includes a cost-effective entry-level version known as the K2. There's no recording facility, but that means its smaller size and straightforward operation could see every firefighter potentially carry one.
Our aim is to get a thermal camera in every firefighter's hand. We do that by using our economies of scale, our expertise and our knowledge on making these products, first of all, very cost effective, but also best performing. So really our aim is to have every firefighter working with thermal technology.
You got the tick?
I've got the tick here, mate, come to me.
Firefighters have to make split-second decisions every time they're called to a fire, but the latest thermal imaging technology from Fleur helps inform and visualise their line of attack. It's a small investment that can make a big difference when it comes to safety, saving lives and protecting property.
Many fire and rescue services are now collaborating to deliver better operational efficiency by maximising crews and optimising technology. Capita provides control room solutions that integrate critical communications and data. Our reporter Kate Recorden went to visit the Network Fire Control Services Partnership to find out how it works.
Fire and Rescue, what's the address of the incident?
The Networked Fire Control Services Partnership has implemented the latest control room technology from Capita to deliver their collaborative vision.
This control room is at the forefront of technology, enabling it to respond to emergencies not only here in Hampshire, but also in Dorset, Wiltshire, Devon and Somerset, as and when the need arises.
We've been supplying solutions for 30 years. We have a market-leading products in communications and in command control. The DS3000 communication product and Vision command control products were brought together to create Vision DS, a control room solution for this project. So we looked at the business process to take us from the incident when the telephone call comes in to the actual dispatch time. And we streamlined the business process working with the NFCSP partnership to ensure that that time was minimised.
This system is one of the most advanced on the market, and it provides my firefighters in the cabs of their fire engines with the most up-to-date information about the risks that they're attending. For me, as the chief officer, of paramount importance is the safety of my firefighters and my crews. And this system will provide the very best information to ensure that they're safe on a dangerous incident.
And the technology has provided the catalyst for change, enabling the partnership to work more collaboratively across the counties than ever before.
The technology has given us the impetus and made it necessary. You know, the computer system is very advanced. It's able to deal with things very effectively. We can see each other's resources. We can see where they are in lifetime. We have common response plans and we're able to operate for each other in a much more seamless way.
Working closely with the four fire and rescue services in the partnership, Capita were able to develop the technology to help fire services transform the way they work. Fire officers are informed of and mobilised to incidents via a range of mobile devices, including smartphone, TomTom sat-nav, airwave radio, pager and mobile data terminal.
We are introducing a common operating picture, so that all fire and rescue services are working to align our operational practices so that we are aware of the practices that are used in all fire and rescue services across the partnership for the safety of the firefighters and the public that we're here to serve.
And they believe it's an investment that will benefit the community for years to come.
When we've got the emergency response, something which is really stable, something that we know will work across the three control centres, we will then be able to focus in the partnership on our prevention work, which, as you know, the Fire and Rescue Service leads on.
One of the key things we never try to take our eye off is that we are providing solutions that protect the public. And so the resilience and the reliability of our solutions is absolutely paramount to us.
The way this project has been delivered, I think, is an exemplar of how public service can work with private organisations such as Capita to ensure that we work in partnership, not in a highly contractual relationship, but in partnership to deliver something for public good.
That's all from Beyond Blue Lights. We hope you've enjoyed the programme. You can catch up with all the latest news and developments in the Fire and Rescue Services on the Chief Fire Officers Association website. But from me and the rest of the team here, goodbye for now.